an explosion at Beaumont, which was not the truth. And I'll explain to you later what would have happened if there would have been a nuclear explosion. I know this is the best copy I could get, but right up here where the arrow is silo 204. That's where the missile was when it exploded. What happened was, it's up on some sort of hill. The heat from the missile was so intense that it melted the warhead, which was loaded with plutonium and uranium. Plutonium at the time was the most dangerous, poison known to man. In fact, it can't come in a liquid form. And if you give your wife mixed in with coffee or tea, it's a silent death that they can never get you for. So if you guys want to do something to your wives or girlfriends, get some plutonium. Meanwhile,
at the Dollar Tree.
It's not really a hill, but it's a slight incline. Before I say that, I'm sorry. It took about 45 minutes to an hour for fire and from McGuire Air Force Base, and the local fire department to get there. Meanwhile, the warhead was burning, the warhead was melting, and the uranium and plutonium was just cascading down the mountain, underneath the fences, underneath the embankments, underneath everything, going into the sewer system, going into the grass, going into the ditches. There were homes not right there, but close by, going into the yards of families, where today, still to this day, people do not, and I repeat, do not grow fruits and vegetables. They're afraid of the plutonium and radiation poisoning. The fire department was able to get the fire out in 1 hour, which was pretty good. Problem is, to put uranium and plutonium fire out, you can't use regular water. You have to use what is called potash or soda ash. I mean, these were guys in the service, 19, 20, 20 years old. They didn't know anything about nuclear fires. They were only surmising what they could do. So they finally got it out, but like I said, everything just seeped through, everything through, literally hundreds and hundreds and miles of land. Got to a point where Russia knew what was happening, but thought it was something else, thinking it was the U.S. getting ready to attack Russia. Luckily, Eisenhower was still president, still had friends from World War II in Russia and every place, and finally they were able to talk Russia down. We were very close to going to what's called DEFCON 3. Mm-hmm. What DEFCON stands for is defense condition. And at the time, the Air Force was on ready alert. Well, that means 15 minutes is all you got. Get in your bombers, get in your jets, and take your ass off. But finally, it was talked down. The Civil Defense Agency heard about this. They were livid that they were informed that people's lives were in danger. as far north as Canada, as far west as California, people's lives were not being affected, but were like, oh my God, what are we gonna do? What are we gonna do? What happened was, again, rumors. I don't know. I was a little boy when I was in 1960. People like Jerry and Marvin and Saul, they were little boys. There were rumors that over 250,000 people were evacuated from the New York area due to this. This Mohawk missile was so important to the country at one time, they actually had a woman by the name of Fran Frost. I'm sure no one knows who the name is, but Fran Frost was Miss Beaumark, 1959. So you can see how popular she was. What happened was, there were 20, to start off, there were 22,000 truckloads and trainloads of soil that had to be transported from the missile site over the years because it was so very contaminated. As recent as 2010, the governor was involved and spent another $20 million cleaning up the area. I mean, it's not something that we take lightly. Let me just see something here. Hold on 1 second. To say that, yes, the missile itself caught fire, the warhead caught fire, and thank God, melted. There's a reason why they say thank God it melted. Because if it did melt and exploded, you're talking about a radius of close to 100 miles where people would have third-degree burns, second-degree burns, blindness. New Jersey wouldn't be New Jersey the way it is today if that bomb exploded. Other than that, there's really not much more to say about Beaumark. I mean, Harry, you were...
Henry.
Henry, you were... I just found that Henry was stationed there on and off, too. Can you tell us anything?
Not really. When I was stationed in the fire, probably early 69 to 73. And I worked in the medical supply area. And we stored stuff over there. And we were there a few times. You know, knew kind of what it was, didn't know specifically what it was. But it was all downplayed to us because, you know, we were there, and obviously there was an issue there. If you go by it today, you still see some of the structures there, but it's all overgrown with, you know, trees and weeds and whatever else, and it's all fenced, whatever. But it's an interesting...
It's a relic of the city.
Yeah.
Okay.
When was the hotline with the Kremlin established?
This?
The hotline, president to president.
You have to talk louder.
Sorry. When, and I think it was Eisenhower's years, was the hotline with the Kremlin established between, so that president to president, we could say, cancel it.
When was the hotline established?
The red
when
phone.
Was the hotline established between the Kremlin and the White House?
That was established in 1962 as a result of the.
Somebody come up here and talk. I'm sorry.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
So, what years did you serve in that area?
He makes fun of me because I'm here.
Tell him, Barry, help me. What year were you there?
Oh, I was there in 1968. Uh-huh. And we were told not to go into this area. Just when I was getting out of the service, the EPA examined all the military personnel that was stationed here over the years. Now you have to understand, this is 75 acres. It's in the middle of nowhere. It's around McGuire Air Force Base. It's near Fort Dix, it's near Lakehurst, but it's in the middle of nowhere. So on any given day, I was part of 7 to 10 security officers that were there, security police. You had a cook, you had a few people. I mean, we didn't actually launch the missile. Can you imagine me launching a missile? My God, we didn't actually launch the missiles, but we sent all the information to McGuire to launch the missile. So anyways, they examined all of us and they said, you're okay. Since 1971 when I got out, I read a couple of reports of guys, liver cancer, bladder cancer, and the government is saying, well, we can't prove that it was because of plutonium uranium. We can't prove that. I mean, the guys that know me here, sorry to say, for the past 12 years, my body's been screwed up with everything and anything there is. Other than that, are there any more questions? Mr. David.
So you mentioned that it overheated, but what was the cause of it? Was that ever determined?
It just overheated.
Was it a malfunction of something?
Was it a malfunction? It's hard to say. I mean, I'm not the technical person of the missiles, but the helium just got too hot and expanded and blew up. Hmm. Okay. I mean, and then it passed on to the warhead, and the warhead melted. And like I said, we're very, very lucky that it melted. It didn't explode, or it would be a different story today. Mm-hmm. And, it was not that the story was hidden from anybody. I'm quite sure. And this is not just asking. Jerry, did you ever hear about stuff like this in 1960?
No.
Saul?
I was only 5 years old. So.
I didn't learn to read at that time.
You guys never heard about this. It was a hidden. Loud.
If you drive south on 539, going south from Egypt or Cameroon, is a missile site. It's right off the road. Yeah. It's surprising how close to the road it is, actually. You look over, going south, it's on the left-hand side, and you'll see the old structures there.
Yeah, the creek's even double fenced for it.
Yeah.
Who else has a question? Bobby.
So, this is the first I've
Transfer it to Dave.
So this is the first I've heard about it, and very interesting. But you kind of have to put things in perspective. In 1959, Castro was at the UN riling up the anti-American rhetoric. And 2 years later, it was the Cuban Missile Crisis. The reason I'm saying this is that I wonder how many more of those types of installations were around New Jersey or around the country. But I do know in Fort Lee, New Jersey, right by the George Washington Bridge, up until the late 50s, there was a battery of missiles ready to protect New York, that area. And they were heavily guarded, but it was kind of an open secret. Everybody knew what it was, but it was there. And I'm wondering, I'm sure there were other types of batteries around, and surprisingly that there weren't more accidents, being that we were lucky.
There were Nike batteries when I was up in West Orange, various places around New Jersey.
Right.
Yeah. Larry,
this is a mountain.
Larry.
Did that stuff ever spill in before the digs? Because McGuire and the digs are interfaced across into the chapter. There's any of that stuff in data when you report digs. You know?
Mr. Muggerstein. Seth?
It's actually closer to the gutter ranges than it is McGuire.
They restrict
a couple of that.
Seth, do you have a question? I was not.
Anybody else? Michael.
Is there any recent information about the current radiation levels in the area?
Is there any what?
Current radiation.
Oh, yeah. There's still, how much radiation in there is not what you call dangerous per se, but you don't want to go down there. Like I said, peoples do not grow fruits and vegetables down there. And a couple of years ago, my wife and I drove past there, and there were signs. The missile base is still there per se, but it's all the buildings are abandoned. The missiles have been gone since 1972 when the program was dissolved. Mm-hmm. And you also have to understand a couple other things. The Beaumont missile was formed because of the Cold War. They needed something to defend the East Coast. And how the Beaumont missile worked was, it would launch, as you see. If you look, it looks like a plane, a jet plane, because it's got the wings. And it would fly to an altitude of 70,000 feet. And when there was an incoming bomber, they would go into their dive mode and explode. They don't hit a target, they explode. And the
mushrooms.
I forget the word.
Concussion?
Huh?
Concussion?
Right. That takes down everything. And then also, when I got there in 1968, that was the height of the Vietnam War. So people were protesting. I mean, we had to have jeeps outside the gate with machine guns on top and armed personnel carriers and everything. In fact, when this fire first occurred, it was during the day, which is lucky that it was during the day. One of the army platoons was doing their march in that area. And when they saw the explosion, the lieutenant said, "Hey, whatever you're doing, drop your gear and let's run." And I mean run. So, you know, like I said, you know, we're quite lucky that the missile melted, didn't explode, or things would be quite different in New Jersey. Any other questions? No. Well, what I'd like everybody to do, please, let me get my phone out. Let me find something.